I want to welcome all of you to this event. My name is Raj Kumar. I'm the President and Editor-in-Chief of DevEx.
I especially want to welcome the folks joining us on the live stream. We have a couple of hundred people from all over the world who are tuning into this special conversation. And I want to give those of you joining from all over a sense of where we are. You can maybe get the feel, looking at the scene, that we're here at the United Nations. We're actually in the Secretariat building here in New York City, down in the basement in the conference room number 8. And what you cannot see if you're joining online, we are surrounded. We've got a full circle here of chief information officers from all over the UN system. These are the CIOs of UN agencies who've flown in from all over the world for an annual meeting of a network of the CIOs. It's a very special opportunity. We want to thank you on behalf of DevEx for allowing us to come into your session and to host this special session. And I want to start off by bringing into the conversation a very special person to lead us off, and that is Ati Riaza, who is, of course, the Chief Information Technology Officer of the United Nations. And you are someone who is dealing every day with various crises. They might be internal crises of a server going down, or they might be global crises that we see on the front page of the newspaper. And we wanted to take an opportunity as DevEx and the DevEx community to think about, what is the role of a chief information officer? What does digital disruption actually mean for international organizations like the ones represented around the table, from the World Food Program to UNICEF to UNHCR? Of course, our community are people working on these issues every day. But we don't talk often enough about the information technology component of the work we do. We think of digital disruption in the private sector. It's highly relevant to the work that happens here at the United Nations. So first of all, thank you for having us.
Thank you, Raj.
And tell us a little bit about, what is your job? What does it mean to be the CIO of the United Nations?
So thank you so much for being here, being with us. Really a pleasure to have you at the UN. And to be joining our audience of DevEx, so thank you. You know, the role of a CIO, I think, it changes almost every 5 years, right? And I always say a good CIO is someone between Churchill, Mother Teresa, and a kamikaze pilot. So it depends in what environment you are and what are your goals and what you're trying to achieve. But ultimately, I think it's about setting a vision, setting a strategy, and having the business and the operation to support you in this strategy and help you deliver it. About 4 years ago, the UN and the member states endorsed the Sustainable Development Goals. These are 17 goals. So most agencies and organizations have 2-3 goals. We have 17.
All 17 really relate to the work you do.
Exactly. It relates to all of our work, and it starts with world peace. So, you know, if you're a CIO and the first goal is world peace, then it goes just down from that point on. But how do you develop technology? How do you implement technology to address the big social issues? This is the question. This is what we ask as CIOs of the UN every day when we come in, is how do we enable our business offices, the business entities, to deliver on their mandates, on their mission, and how do we create this space for innovation?
And you're doing that in a world with lots of constraints. I mean, your budgets are never as big as you want them to be, and we're in an era of budget cuts, not budget increases. You've got people throughout the UN system who are using IT in their own projects or in their own work that might not be directly controlled or managed by a CIO. Give us a sense of the constraints you're living under, you yourself, but also the broader group that's represented here.
I think the fiscal constraints are huge. I mean, we at the UN, and I always give this example, that if you look at how much the world spends on military, it's about $1.7 trillion. The peacekeeping budget for the UN is about $7 billion. So just put it into context. When you talk to my other colleagues, and they can tell you the amount of money that they spend on addressing these big social issues. So funding is a big issue. I think the second issue we have is capacity. Building capacity within the offices, within the ICT, within our business units, but also within the member states. Technology is moving so fast. There is this exponential growth that's coming in. But the way we work, our processes, our structures, the funding is not growing exponentially. And what we see is definitely a shortage of capacity and investment, not having sufficient time to deploy technology, because by the time we get to deploy something, it's actually obsolete. And UN is an international quasi-government organization, which means we have many policies and structures and governance. And the dialogue that we need to have around deployment of solutions that impact the mandates. And at the same time, a huge responsibility.
Yeah, you've got a lot of data that's very sensitive. You've got a mission and a mandate, many of the agencies represented here that are really critical and that you've got to maintain. You can't just take a big risk that a private company or a startup might be able to take.
Absolutely, and it comes to risk because, you know, I look at risk as probability of harm, and we don't want it to harm. And I think when we think about innovation and technology and privacy and identity and these are the issues that we have to deal with every day. With innovation and technology, there's been a lot of great things that's come out of it. You look at e-health, e-education, you look at this closing of a digital divide, the impact in the financial sector, and digital cash. So there's a lot of wonderful thing. But when you look at the UN's mandate, peace and security is on top of the list in terms of UN mandate. You have development, rule of law, human rights. What we see is that technology and innovation has created a space where a lot of criminal activity has shifted to the dark web. So now an organization like UNODC, who is accountable for drug trafficking, money laundering, human trafficking, is struggling with trying to see what they can do in a dark web. So in terms of investment, in terms of capacity, in terms of support, we are benefiting from technology and innovation to some extent, but we also have to mitigate on many levels. When we think about cybersecurity and its risk on peace and security, we see intrusions from member states to others or from different groups into industrial systems. How do we mitigate? How do we help member states mitigate and build capacity? How do we mitigate ourselves?
Your own risks,
so,
yeah.
Absolutely. So risk to us is a whole different perspective of protection of human life and basic rights. And some of that we can do through the use of technology. Some of that has become aggravated because of technology. And that's where we seek partnership and we seek support from the academia, from the private sector, trying to help us solve those issues.
I want to get in the later part of the discussion more into partnership. We're going to come back to hear from people who are joining us in the live stream and others about how you might partner with some of the CIOs around the table. But I just want to, for a second, focus in on the challenges that you're facing. And I wonder whether the UN reform, I just interviewed the Secretary General a couple of weeks ago, does the reform agenda of the Secretary General affect the work of the people around the table here? Does it affect your work, and how so? Does it get to any of these issues you just brought up?
I think so. I think the Secretary General's vision about reform is simplicity, agility, flexibility, much simpler delegation to the field, so the field and the operations in the field can move as quickly as it can to deliver on its mandates. The reform also talks about combining entities that have similar vision and goals, not so much combining structurally, but combining where they can have a common focus and work together to deliver on the mandate. The reform on peace and security, which is further integration of DPA and DPKO. The reform on development, to bringing in more synergy across the resident coordinators. And of course, the management reform. So when we change organizations, IT always has to change to support it. That's one key area. But the Secretary General's strategy on technology is what is very critical to us as CIOs. Because in that strategy, he's talking about the frontier issues, and he's talking about a digital UN, and how do we embrace technology so we can respond better, we could be more effective, we can move away from crisis reaction to crisis prevention, which is what we want to be. How do we deploy artificial intelligence, but how do we have ethical dialogue and conversation about its impact globally? Because he fully understands that technology can mitigate, but it can aggravate. And we are in a business of dealing with so many social issues, and some of them going back to cybersecurity, going back to identity theft, going back to crime and criminal activity in a dark web. Those are issues that we have to respond to, and we have entities that have mandates and missions to respond to. So I think that the concept of reform is something that is very dear to his heart, is very dear to us, and it would create that digital journey for the UN, both internally and externally as it comes to working on the program side.
A digital UN, pretty compelling concept. Give me a sense of what might that actually look like? Like, how would the UN be different if it's more digital?
I think we would use data a lot more effectively. I think we would be a lot more open, and with the NGOs, we are open, but in terms of technology and innovation, integrate better internally and externally. Our processes would be a lot more efficient and simpler, perhaps. But on the program side, I think we would use technology to address big social issues. So you think about the advancements in technology, in e-health, in education, even in supply chain, areas of robotics, where we have a lot of peacekeepers in the field, and we have staff in the field, areas that are just not safe and not good, or areas that we can't get to from a supply chain perspective. So those are areas that we can look at about becoming more effective as we respond to crisis, but also working more effectively internally across different entities.
Do you see it as a kind of a continuum between risk and innovation? And how do you get away, how do you manage those risks, but also get the innovation that you want to have in order to become a digital UN? Give us a sense of how you're getting there.
You know, it's hard with innovation, as they say, innovative people are pain in the neck, right? Nobody wants innovative people because they change everything, they're disruptive.
Right.
But you can't kind of put a rope around innovation, because then you would kill its vitality. So how do you manage risk? I mean, the one issue that kind of keeps me awake at night is, how do we innovate responsibly? And how do we understand causality? Because a lot of times we innovate, and 20, 30, 40 years later, we see the impact, negative or even on some level, the completely unrelated consequence of innovation. So innovation in general requires much broader thinking about what is the impact of what I'm doing on the environment, what is on society, what's the impact on the economy. I always use the example of e-waste. You know, we never thought, we all have these mobile devices, but we never thought about how we're going to get rid of them. If you look at the impact of e-waste in China, in India, mercury, lead, if you burn it, it's dioxin. This is just poisoning the environment. But we innovated, we didn't think about the risk, and now we don't even have a plan around e-waste. So I think risk is something that I don't know whether we can fully understand. You know, David Hume said the cause and effect is based on our perception of our mind. If we don't experience the effect of something, we can't really determine long-term effect. And therefore, with innovation, we need to better understand risk as innovators. And this is a message to the tech sector especially, because the world is changing and we are innovating constantly. So I hope that we understand it, and the risk to us, I think, is the risk to the world. There's huge benefit of technology and innovation, but the risk exists and the risk is there. And we always ask for support and partnership to address the big issues of risk, because the big issues of risk of, let's think about artificial intelligence, huge innovation, extremely important, but if it does cause unemployment in areas of agriculture, manufacturing, farming, supply chain, how would that impact economies of the countries? And how can we deal with the consequences of the risk? So that's just one tiny example.
My sense is you're, in a way, redefining the role of the CIO. And I want to get your reaction to, do I have this right? That the CIO role for you, or maybe for a CIO of a UN agency, would have been in the past focused on internal, what, you know, the internal systems that are required to run an operation at the UN, and then programmatic work. So especially for the development organizations, the programs that they're running. But maybe now there's a third, which is an external voice on some of these kinds of issues that go beyond just what the organization itself does. Is that how you see the role?
We do see it that way. I think the CIOs, there's been an IT paradox, and the paradox, and we've kind of passed that, is that we used to think IT was about the hardware, software, and tools, and the CIO's role was to manage iron. We've gone past that, and we are transitioning to managing information. That's the first phase of, I think, us passing the paradox. But I see our role as becoming a catalyst and becoming a connector, where we bring in different sectors and we bring in member states and we bring in innovation, and we try to use technology and innovation to address the big issues of mandate, the sustainable development goals, do a lot more on the program side, because we've, and I think this is a trend you see in the private sector or in government, where we're becoming more data scientists, we're becoming enablers of new ways of working. We're using cloud services, we're using outsourcing, we're using solutions a lot more, so we can shift our talent to a space where they could become partners with the business on the program side to say, okay, let's see, how do we solve that social issue? And where can technology help address that issue? Or how do we build capacity within the entity to be able to mitigate the risk that comes in? That's the role we are stepping into, and I think over the next 5 years, you'll see more and more as the UN CIO is trying to bring the rest of the world in to help address some of these big issues that we are confronted, and solve it together than solve it by ourselves within the organizations we manage.
So let's dig into those questions a little bit more. You brought up some innovation and technology. I'd love to bring into the conversation two other CIOs, if I can. Please join me in welcoming Daniel Couture, the CIO of UNICEF, and Doug Green, who's the CIO of UNHCR. Thank you both for being part of this conversation. I'd love to get a sense, when we talk about technology and innovation, well, what really is happening? And what's getting the two of you excited when you think about the program work of your agencies, of serving refugees, of serving children? There's a lot of conversation that you see it on the pages of DevEx about AI or blockchain or drones, you name it, off-grid energy. What are you actually using? What's exciting to you? Where do you see an opportunity to really move the needle? Danielle.
Yeah, I can start. So thank you, Raj. Nice to spend time with you. As you know, UNICEF is protecting the rights of children around the world, and there's five major focus areas. We want every child to learn and strive. We want every child to have be protected from violence and exploitation. We want to have a safe and clean environment, and equity. So these are the five major pillars. And within that, technology plays a role in every one of them. So it's hard to determine one area over any other. I mean, take learning and education, for example. The technical tools to increase learning is becoming very much more available right now. So this is an area that's very important and dear to us. But beyond that, I think generically, technology can be used for better engagement with our beneficiary, to have direct feedback from the quality of the service and the change that we're making, the impact we're making with children around the world by collecting their impact, their insights. It also helps us enhance our delivery of service, also come up with new services that we can deliver. Think about cash. So we're able to now use technology in a much more different way to deliver cash to beneficiaries in humanitarian example.
We still call it cash, but I assume when you talk about cash, you mean electronic delivery
in some ways,
of funds, right?
Yeah, depending on where you are, but yeah, this is where we're going. But some areas which are less privileged, we're still...
It's still physical cash.
Still banknotes or whatnot. And the last one is more using technology to really have real-time measurement of our activities, so we could really adjust real-time our delivery, or go in areas that we didn't anticipate would have, you know, a need in certain ways. So we could use that with the new technology that's available. Nowadays, we have connectivity around the world to a rate of over 80%, which is very good. Data has been, you know, more available in the last 3 years than it's ever been, so the majority of data. So we could leverage those two to really change the way that we deliver programs. So this is what really excites me. And beyond that, there are exciting platforms such as blockchain, such as AI, that we could leverage all this data. But essentially, I think what I'm interested in is helping those underprivileged children through the use of technology. So we say, you know, every program now is a digital program. So we do need to think about how we deliver our programs digitally at the outset. So that requires a huge change in the way we approach program design, for example.
A huge change, yeah. It's very much like this idea of a digital UN. You know, every program being digital is a big change. We'll get more into that, but I want to get Doug into the conversation too. What's exciting to you at UNHCR? What are you really moving the needle on in terms of a digital transformation?
Yes, thank you, Raj, for having me. I think you mentioned it, Nadi talked about it. Our role has changed dramatically over the last 5 to 10 years, away from focus on back office and internal. We're really being asked to step up and engage more in the programmatic side. So UNHCR, you know, our primary mandate is protection of people who happen to cross the border, don't have the protection of their previous state. So we're an organization of a lot of lawyers and not too many with much of an IT background. But what we've seen is that, for example, distance learning is certainly one area that Daniel talked about. But for us, probably the three most exciting technologies that we've been working on the last 3 years is certainly biometrics, biometric identification, which has been key to when a refugee comes into our protection, we are able to identify them biometrically. We take their bio data, and throughout the process, we know who came in is the same person that hopefully will return to their home country.
Can I just pause on that?
Sure.
One? Because I think there's 1.1 billion people in the world who still are not identified.
Yep.
And there's a lot of potential using biometrics that you can ramp up quickly. Of course, India's famous Aadhaar program.
Yep.
What is your sense? You're close to this in a way many others are not.
Yep.
How fast is this going to move?
So we actually partner with Accenture. We're using their technology, and Aadhaar was certainly, they were there as well. It's not inexpensive, I'll say. It's very expensive to deploy to large numbers of people. It is relatively easy. There's 20 million refugees in the world. We have 7 million refugees that are in our case management system. So we're about two-thirds of the way there registering biometrically. And you know, certainly it's proven to reduce fraud. For example, in Kenya, in Dadaab, when we had everyone go back through the system, the refugee population fell from 450,000 to 360,000. A lot of Kenyans were in these camps. And so, for example, World Food Program, our colleagues are here, about an $8 million reduction in fraud and food distribution. So, you know, there are benefits. There are also, you know, what keeps me up at night is the security, the privacy, data privacy, and you know, the ensuring that nothing happens to that data.
Yeah, you're holding some pretty important personal data. Go ahead, Daniel.
Yeah, of this 1.1 billion, there's 450 million children without identity. So it's really important. There are some ethical issues, there are some normative issues that come along with that biometrics area. But the identity is one of the biggest nut to crack, in my view. You have the official identity and the acquired identity. You know that, you know, there's 1.1 billion Facebook users. They have identity, they're acquired identity. So this is a whole area that we have an opportunity to work together and to sort out from that perspective.
From a biometric identity, the second area I would say is a digital identity, which is, you know, we certainly couldn't have gotten through a session without talking about blockchain, but I don't necessarily want to talk about it too much. We're taking a cautious approach. We don't want any personal information out there. We certainly interview refugees and their families. Our case management system has complete histories. We have a lot of hacking attempts to get at data, and it's life or death for us. So when we, you know, we have 12 million stateless people in the world, and a lot of them children. So it is important to certainly move down this road of a digital identity. A lot of the services that people could get access to and so forth are critical. We've talked into Estonia there, eGov is certainly well known. However, tons of privacy questions, the targeting of people if that data gets out, and a lot of human rights, ethical issues, they're constantly hacking. And honestly, that's why we are partnering more and more with the private sector. We believe that they can certainly do security much better than we can with our own data centers and our own staff.
Yeah, and I cut you off before. You were going to say a third area, I think.
The third is kind of near and dear to my heart. It's connectivity for refugees. And this is, you know, our refugees are in places where, you know, connectivity is you know, 2G may be available. We found that most refugees actually have a device. In fact, when we've interviewed them when they've crossed a border, some will say their most important device was their phone, and you know, they use it for news, to let loved ones know that they're safe, to Facebook users to be able to connect back, for mobile payments. So we see connectivity is key. Cash assistance is another area that we're in as well. So to the base services, connecting with communities you know, so that's one, and maybe we can talk about that a little bit more, because that's one where we really want to partner with the private sector.
And I'd like to bring Athi back into the discussion too, because I often think in the development community there's a lot of discussion about the mobile phone. Mm-hmm. Almost every, you know, program that you look at has some kind of mobile phone component, which is great. But in a way, the development community was late to this. This was a private sector-led push where suddenly we woke up and everybody had cell phones everywhere. I know Jim Kim at the World Bank is saying that he's talking to telecom executives. He's spending a lot of time in Silicon Valley, and they're telling him the move to smart devices and the connectivity curve is going to move much faster than we realize. It could be as soon as 2025 that basically the remaining part of the world that doesn't have connection is connected. Are we ready? I mean, are the institutions that serve populations that we might still think of as cut off ready for a pretty near-term future in which everybody is connected?
That's a great question. I think, the entities that serve this population are governments. Mm-hmm. They're NGOs. It's the UN. And we do like to have a connected world, but we want to have a connected world where we respect people's dignity, people's identity, privacy, and we don't have that.
Yeah.
And I really, yes, I would like this digital divide closed. I really want people connected. But we have not had the conversation about how do we protect them. And we are not protecting them. And I'm very scared of having someone who has little money and they have now the money on their phone and that's hacked into and that's lost. How do we deal with that? So I think we almost have to pause and say, from a policy perspective, from a protection perspective, from a dignity perspective, how do we deal with that issue? Because you heard Doug talk about the refugee data, right? It's being hacked into, and the issue of risk, and that's just identity. And I think unless we come together as academia, private sector, UN, NGOs, governments, and think about protection of people, this is got a huge risk. Huge upside. Because when you connect people, then they have access to education, healthcare, commerce, the farmers can find out where they can sell their goods. But we are not protecting them. We can protect them in a physical world, yeah, maybe.
But
a little
it's
bit.
The Wild West.
It's the Wild, Wild West, right? And I don't hear the dialogue. There's no dialogue about that. There's only dialogue about expansion. Mm. So this is really when we have to pause and we have to talk about expansion comes with protection. And let's think about where is that protection. So I hope we can invite the private sector here, and we do. We have events where they come, where we can have those intellectual conversations and those policy conversations.
I want to bring others into the discussion, but before we do, let's get a little further on this question of partnership. Because, you know, the DevEx community includes corporations, foundations, NGOs, social entrepreneurs who might be listening to this and thinking, you know, they'd love to be a part of working together to solve some of the issues they're working on, similar issues to what you are. Partnership is tough when you think of the UN. You know, I talk to people in the UN and they say, we'd love to partner, but we have procurement rules, we have limited budgets, you know, our hands are sometimes tied, we have some risk aversion, but for good reasons. Talk to corporations and they say, well, we'd love to sell to the UN, but they don't always realize the budgets actually aren't that big, or they're largely spoken for. How do we get to a model of actual partnership or kind of an innovative ecosystem as opposed to where we are today? I wonder if any of you have senses of this, or do you see some success stories out there we should know about?
Go ahead, Doug.
Give it a shot.
I was in the private sector for 9 years as well, and
yeah,
it's
all three of you actually have a private sector background, which I'm sure is very useful in this role.
And you know, as sort of the nonprofit world, we don't quite understand. You know, we think profit and is a bad thing, and we expect companies to make a lot of money just to give over cash. You know, it's just not what it's about. And from the private world, they don't quite understand us either. So I think we have to figure that one out a little bit better. What we did with Connectivity for Refugees, you know, our normal thing is we have to build things. We in these areas where there's no connectivity, we'll put in a VSAT terminal. We'll provide connectivity to our staff, a 1.5 meg, which is not much capacity at all. So when we talk about Connectivity for Refugees, internally we were like, yeah, we'll just put up a bunch of VSAT terminals. It's quite expensive. We took a totally different approach. It was all about sustainability and partnering with the private sector. So Vodacom, we worked with Vodacom in northern Tanzania in near Gusu camp, and we said there's, you know, 120,000 Congolese and Rwandans in this camp, and you'd see them holding up their cell phones trying to get a signal, and we said, why don't you put a tower in the camp? And there, you know, we said, so we were more advocating, you know, there's got to be a business case here. So not only did they put a tower, we didn't provide anything, power. There was a recent article that said the revenue from that terminal, that tower in the camp, was twice what it was for in anywhere else in Tanzania. So they put two more towers in other camps. It was a perfect thing. We advocated. Refugees have money. They have remittances. And so that's how we solved that problem, just by connecting, refugees with private companies.
You have a thought on this?
It's a very big challenge, and I think we won't be able to meet the goals of the SDG without private sector. That's a given. So how do we do this is the challenge. And, you know, the idea of having a shared value partnership is what we probably need to think about. What is it? What is in this for the private sector?
Right.
What's in this for the government? What's in this for the UN? And we get around the table and we figure out, you know, how do we do this program or this partnership? So that's the only way it's going to happen.
Yeah, the word that's used a lot
now. And it takes
is,
time, right, to do this.
And the word used a lot now is co-creation, which is exactly this idea, getting around the table as equals, as peers. That's a very hard thing to actually pull off, given the mandates of institutions
right.
like yours.
Yeah, so that's probably what we need to start or continue to think about if we want to do this at scale. In the meantime, you know, we have a number of discussions and small pilots, but at scale, it's going to require this shared value discussion. We do have some examples, for example, with financial private sector company, having them help us with our fundraising activities and our engagement activities in Africa, for example, get a sense of their knowledge in analytics so we could look at the database of supporters. And at the same time, what's in it for them is a future market that they're able to develop. So if we're able to share some of that data, it's one example, but it's a very long process.
Yeah, there's many companies that are actually not looking to sell anything into your institutions, but there may be a shared vision of a market an ecosystem they can be part of. I'm thinking about especially the move to financial inclusion and all the telcos and the banks and others that have an interest in that space. I do want to get others in. I see people are starting to tweet questions. Continue to tweet them at DevEx. We'd love to see your questions on Twitter. We'll get to any that we can. But especially for the CIOs who are in the room, does anybody have an intervention they would like to make, a question or something they can add to the discussion that you think we might have missed so far? And Anathi, feel free if you want to jump in on this point.
I would wait for others, otherwise I wanted to...
Please, go ahead, and we'll take your question right after.
Thank you. So I want to talk about an experience that we've had with the private sector and the member state, actually. So partnership is expanding on an innovation lab that we are opening up in Finland. So here's a member state sponsoring an innovation hub, bringing in the local private sector. We're coming in, and it's designed around sustainable development goals, and Finland's picking a couple of goals that's important to them. And we'll innovate around that, and other innovation labs hopefully will open up after the pilot. And the technology solutions are given to the technology bank to give it to other member states. So these are different models that we're using for partnership, which I think is critical. The second partnership we like to do is we want to partner with all of you out there. We want to partner with millions and millions of innovators because we know we just cannot solve these problems ourselves. But we can together do that. We own the issue. You know, the first goal of peace, I don't only own it as a CIO of the UN. Daniel doesn't only own it. Doug doesn't own it. We own it. Then I would say, why would a private sector ask what is in it for them? What's in it for them is peace. And, or it is, I don't know, gender equity, or it's the environment, because our goals are their goals. And their goals are our goals. And I think if we go to what you said about common vision, this is a vision for the world. So how do we innovate? How do we think about addressing them together versus saying, you got to buy that product for me to help you address it? It's a changing of a conversation. Yeah.
That's a great point because, you know, we often do think about the technology sector as big technology companies, which there are many and they're important, but there's also lots of individuals mm-hmm. who can contribute and do on open platforms. Of course, we think of Wikipedia as a place that people just contribute in open collaboration, but mm-hmm. GitHub has 20 million web developers and engineers who contribute, you know, open source code. And I guess this idea is, can you open the UN to that? Can you put some of your challenges out there to mm-hmm. a much broader global audience? Do you think that's possible?
Yes, I am. I mean, there are a number of innovation principles, and you know, one of them is design with the user, designs for scale, do no harm, and open source. So I think that the agreement, the commercial agreement that we're passing on, we do need to think differently and engage the millions of people out there to Addie's point in that.
Who wants to jump in around the table? Anyone?
Don't be shy.
And let's see, I know we have some questions, I believe, coming in on Twitter. Let me see if I can get to any of them. But while we get there, let me just ask this question as I'm looking this up. You know, I can imagine a skeptic watching this saying, okay, but this is similar to what you might have said last year, the year before. Are we really moving? I mean, the scale of the challenges, whether it's a refugee challenge or a climate challenge, the scale is so big. Are your institutions actually disrupting yourselves fast enough? Or what? Because this partnership conversation has been around for a while. Some of the words we're using are nice, but is there urgency?
Yeah, I would say we're getting much better, honestly. I've been 5 years with UNHCR. I think we have a much better understanding of the shared value, as Daniel was talking about. I think it's still a long road, but you know, I think, for example, we partner quite closely with Microsoft. We on the commercial side, we do a lot of business, obviously. The Tech for Social Impact, the philanthropic arm, I mean, they've made it very clear that they will invest with you know, corporate social responsibility dollars to get things moving. But they've also made it clear that they are a commercial company. So it takes a little bit of infusion of capital to get things going. And so, for example, we would rather target our resources to vulnerable families, single-headed households, whether it's the cost of smartphones is fairly small in when we think about it. It's like $40 to get the low-end smartphone. That's a huge purchase for a refugee. But once you can get over that, so it's like subsidizing phones and maybe a monthly plan, but let the private sector deal with providing the connectivity is just one example. The whole cash assistance area is another, and how we deal with that. And
that's moving pretty quickly.
It is moving very quickly. You have a lot of interest from the private sector, MasterCard, Accenture, and a lot of people are into it. But the challenges that we face is that we do have procurement rules. So the example I talked about Vodacom is just to say, we were just trying to connect some. There was no transaction for us. But when you have, if you have a company that's willing to fund a pilot or do something and then want to scale, and you say, well, we need to now do an RFP, and it's going to be a competition, then kind of throws the whole thing a little bit off. But those are the challenges. It's kind of the procurement rules, the process.
The RFP model, suggests that
you've got an idea what the problem is, and you want to buy a solution.
That's right.
But so often, these are ecosystem issues. This isn't about buying a one-off solution. As you said before, a one-off solution might be install some, VSATs and get connectivity. But you're actually talking about a much broader thing that you can't design an RFP around, necessarily.
That's right.
Go ahead.
The other thing I would add, yes, it is a long process. We're making progress. We're making baby steps. But we're also starting to work much closer and collaborate across our different agencies and organizations. So, for example, a couple of examples of the UN partner portal that we're working together in some instances of cash transfer. In the child protection area, we are collaborating with UNHCR and with IRC on case management and gender-based violence and some of the IT sector, because we want to move all this to the cloud and so be repeatable and scalable. So we're making progress, but it's small baby steps. So we really need to crank the volume much more.
I know IRC, for example, says they've hit their target already on cash, and they're thinking about ways to use it in other aspects of their organization. I think that is one in the humanitarian sector. It's one of the more disruptive, immediate kinds of opportunities. We do have a question that's come in on Twitter from Anu Hatalampi for you. Ms. Riazi, how do you see the role of girls and women in building capacity and addressing the digital skill shortage in member states? This is kind of a cross-cutting theme. Of course, even in the IT sector, there's a big imbalance. So many roles are still filled by men. You're maybe a shining example as the CIO here of the UN in your role. So what's your thought to this question from Anu?
No, that's such a great question, so thank you for asking it. I have two 11-year-olds, and I've done my best trying to get them to love STEM and science and learn how to code. Of course, I've said this to them. I've said, you can play a game after you write a game. So, when do we move as women from consumers of tech to be contributors of tech? That's a big change. And I think it involves a lot of how we bring up the girls and the boys as families and as parents and as teachers, as counselors, right? And all of those steps, we keep making the stereotype mistakes about the girls and about the boys. So that's one thing I want to put on the table, because I think we all own the problem. Girls typically see the tech sector as boring and dull, and the fact is today it's really changed. And it wasn't boring and dull then, at least for me, but now we've moved off really coding or moved off infrastructure, things that they thought it was dull and boring. We've moved to the space where technology is addressing big issues. We've moved to experience of technology. We've moved to data analytics. We've moved to areas of innovation and convergence of technology like nanotech, organic semiconductors, robotics. These are things that are very interesting for women and girls, where you can have social impact. So I advocate for women, especially girls, to study STEM. And I think we have to really, and I see some changes happening in education sector where there's a lot more teaching of STEM. Mm-hmm. I think opportunities for women to be in the science area is expanding. I know the Secretary General is really serious about gender equity. And since he's been with us, he's pushed for having more women in key technical roles. So it is an issue. I think it's changing. Mm-hmm. At least it's not so much changing in the U.S. yet, because when I graduated from college, we had more women graduating in engineering and computer science than we do today. That's just not a good trend to have. That's not a good trend. Although we are getting a lot more women in other countries who are studying STEM and science. So it is a big issue, and I hope that we can close it.
And these issues are all connected. You're reminding me of a telecom executive I met who told me that his company saw lower rates of usage of their product, of their cell phone, in South Asia among teenage girls. And they thought, well, this is just a market problem. We have an opportunity to make some more money. We want to get teenage girls using phones. So they went and created discounts and promotions and advertising and did all those things. And it didn't work. And they went and actually started to talk to people in communities and found, well, it wasn't really an issue of not wanting the product or not being able to afford the product. It was more an agency issue that maybe their parents or their family, it just wasn't appropriate for them to use a phone as the way they looked at it, whereas a young boy could. And these things are all very connected. And if a young girl can't get access to the technology to begin with, then thinking about her future sitting around this table is a challenge.
Yes, absolutely. And there are lots of women still today don't have access to a cell phone. And when you don't have an access to a mobile phone, you don't have financial independence, you can't have banking. I mean, it just has serious economic issues. So yes, I think we have to get into the fundamental issues of how do we get more women and girls in the science area? How do we get more men? Because if you look at the U.S., the number of men entering sciences, at least engineering and IT, has dropped as well. So this is an issue. When the future is technology, and we have to really be contributors of it, we are opting out. And I think we don't have the opportunity and we don't have the option to opt out, because women are consumers of 90%. 90% of electronics are consumed by women. Women purchase them. They may not consume them. They buy it for their children. They buy it for their husband. And that includes a lot of, you know, washing machine, dishwasher. I'm not only talking about the telephones. And I think they have to participate in this. So I think, and I hope as society we understand the fundamentals behind why we are not getting enough women in that space.
We're talking a lot about the human capacity side. I just want to talk about money for a second. I think your budget is something like $500 million, which may sound big, but in many ways is small given how big your mandate is here at the UN Secretariat. I imagine all of you around the table have to go and make this case. You can talk about a digitally disruptive world and the opportunity to change, but in the end, when I talk to CIOs at NGOs, at even private companies, at social enterprises, technology is still often seen as like a line item in the budget, as opposed to an enabler. Is that still the case for all of you? Do you feel you have to go and kind of make this case internally? And where do you think we are in making the argument as a global development community, as international organizations, around the value of IT not just being a tool, but actually being fundamental to the way you work?
Yeah, I would say that, I mean, my IT budget's about 2% of a total, so it's definitely not sufficient. We'd like to be at the 4%, which is industry average. The only uptick I've had in the last 3 years is in cybersecurity. So clearly, there's a recognition on our senior leaders that we have to do more in that space. Where we've also been the most successful from a project perspective is when we make the business case for things like our refugee case management, our biometrics identity management system, things that they can see directly tied to programs. Back office or infrastructure, network, it's like deaf ears, but that's where we've been able to make the most progress or from a business case perspective.
Danielle, please.
Well, I won't say it too loud, but we are not having that discussion. I think we've moved beyond that discussion and integrating the investment that digital required in digital in the program investment. So it's viewed as a whole. Along with that, we've got in place the right level of conversation and participation in the creation of our plans. We have a very cross-functional governance group that looks at the plan, the investment, the relationship of our investments versus other programs or other investments. So we're not having the line item discussion at this point, which is good news. Is this enough? Probably never enough, but we do have the right conversation. So I won't say it too loud, but yeah.
So I think that from on our side, I mean, the budget for peacekeeping IT and emissions and overall IT comes to that amount. But a lot of it, I think the question is, what are we spending it on? And how do we shift the spend from infrastructure and things to solutions that enable us to deliver better on our mandate?
There's a lot of money going to hardware.
Presumably. It's going, exactly. I think when you have large peacekeeping operations and you are in places where you are the network, you are your own power system, you are the air traffic system, you are the aviation, I think you get to spend a lot on technology and IT. When you think about funding, and the funding that we have for the problems we have is a drop in a bucket, right? You look at the SDGs and you look at the big issues confronting us and confronting the world. Children, right? You talk about 20 million people are trafficked, half of them children, right? 78% women. There's no way he's gonna be able to build products that he can monitor and track and see where the kids are and not only stop the trafficking, but feeding the, I mean, you think about these problems, there's not enough money anywhere. And I think that there has to be a better way. There has to be a different way that we can, together with other sectors, with the member states, with governments, to figure out how do we address these issues. So it doesn't matter if it's this big or this big, it's still so tiny. So I just want to put that on the table because we struggle with that. We are generally optimistic people. We are CIOs, sure. Right? We wouldn't be doing this job if we weren't optimistic. But every day when we come in and we look at the mission of the organization and we look at what we have to do, we go home depressed because we feel that we have not been able to move the needle. But I believe that together with opening up the UN, with reaching out to millions of people out there, reaching out to the private sector and saying, let's own the problem together, because when unemployment goes down, when healthcare goes up, when people are not hungry, they become good consumers, right? And when they're good consumers, they buy. So there is money to be made in addressing big social issues. And that is our message today, is how do we begin that conversation?
That's a wonderful message. I want to see if anyone else among our CIOs wanted to jump in. I do want to say that we've had a couple of thoughts on Twitter. I'm just going to wrap them up around health. We haven't really gotten into that topic so much. We talked about e-health a little bit, that the topic came up. But do you see a real opportunity for disruption there, maybe particularly you, Danielle, given the work that you're doing in the health space?
There is, and I think it's already started. So, there's a number of tools available, a number of open source methods available as well that we are leveraging in partnership with governments and whether it's local governments or governments in general that are out there. And the question is, how do we bring the resources together to make sure that these platforms are scalable?
Yeah, I was about to ask, because there's so many pilots still, and this is the usual complaint I get, is pilotitis, that there's a blockchain initiative or there's a diagnostics initiative, but how do you get it to scale? Do you still feel blocked in that, or do you think the coalitions have come together, the innovative financing mechanism, the partners, where we're able to get to scale on some of these innovations?
I don't think there's a, what do you say that, the silver lining. I think it's going to be happening country by country. I don't think there is a global platform.
Okay.
So it all depends on the readiness of the government to straighten their system and the availability at the local level of the appropriate partners, whether it's the institutions or NGOs or governments or private sector, to scale those. I believe we have the raw material. It's a matter of assembling it. It's a matter of engaging with the governments and to roll those out. I believe that. And in learning and repeating those patterns country by country.
Doug, we heard from Athi kind of a call to action, to partner with the UN. I wonder, for your case at HCR, what kinds of partnerships are you looking for? Is there an open opportunity for organizations to work with you on such a big issue like refugees?
You know, we have a couple of internal partnership, private sector partnership groups that are actively reaching out. The tendency is toward tech companies, and that's fine, that's good. I think we have to go beyond the tech companies and partner in different ways. There's as I said, we're getting better at it. I recall several years at Davos, several years ago at Davos, we went in, I'll mention it was HP, and we get to the table, and there was this pause, and it was Mark Hurt at the time, and said, well, what do you need? And we're like, well, what can you provide? And it's like, that's not how it works. You know, you have to come with something you need. And we were like, well, we don't know. What can you do for us? And it was just, so I think the dialogue has to increase, and we have to just do a better job of figuring out where there can be synergies around this. I think, you know, when I was at the American Red Cross, this whole thing of in disasters of being able to locate people that are missing and putting up platforms is brilliant. You know, those kinds of things where, you know, the Red Cross, we would try to do that, and all of a sudden, you know, Facebook and these things just emerge. So I think we're seeing much more of that. You know, that we should applaud those kind of things that just form. They don't always have to be instigated by, you know, the UNHCR because the refugees are a mandate. But now we're certainly, as we get better at understanding what partnerships mean, the shared value, as Daniel talked about, I think, you know, the disruption will just continue and take off even
and
more than this.
And why do you want to get past tech companies? What's the reason for wanting to make sure you broaden that?
There are a lot of other companies that have interests in refugees. There's amazing numbers of companies that were formed by refugees, you know, a refugee founder. And so it's not only the tech sector, I think, that we should be targeting. Yeah. It's just a personal opinion.
I think every company is now a tech company. So, whether you're in the logistics or transportation, I mean, the world is changing. A lot more digital plays much more bigger role in every company nowadays. So to your point, whether it's a tech company or a company that uses digital as a new business model, there are partners we want to partner with.
We've more or less run out of time here. We did get a few questions in from Twitter that we didn't get to, but I think we've more or less covered them. One, maybe Athi, that you can close us on, is you've talked about a lot of the risks and a lot of the challenges. You've talked about what keeps you up at night. What excites you? What is there that kind of you're giving us a call to action already, but where are you excited about the big opportunity ahead as we close out this session?
So maybe I give you an example of Rwanda. You know, Rwanda, and you talked about health, has 11 million people and 600 doctors. In US, 11 million people have 33,000 doctors. I put on a table because I think technology can address these big issues, because if we had a good e-health system that did diagnostics and triage, and 80% of problems could be diagnosed through AI and through a system, we address that issue without having 33,000 doctors sent to Rwanda, right? So I think technology plays this critical role to address the big social issues. I'm a big believer in it. I don't think it's been a ripe space for the tech sector to invest in these issues, but I hope they do. Because as we invest more and more in innovation to address social issues, healthcare, education, environment, more and more we will see that some of the issues we confront will go away. And as they go away, then we can begin to deal with other issues that come up. But I think there's the basic issues of health, food, refugees, environment, all those issues, I think technology can play a critical role. And my ask is that as we innovate, we should innovate responsibly. We should understand what's the risk, and we should have the new structure, political structure, economic structure, social structure that supports that new environment, that new world that we create. Because we are creating a new world. We have moved from being Homo sapiens to what I call the Homo mobilis, because we are nothing without our mobile phones, especially the youth, to a connected sapiens, and very soon to this combination of carbon and silicon with AI, right? Yeah. We're moving to a new species. And I think we should be able to resolve these basic issues of human beings, such as hunger and disease and healthcare. So I hope that we can, within the use of technology and innovation, address those big issues, and we want to be a part of it.
Well, thank you for sharing that vision. Thank you, Atefa Riazi, for sharing this platform for us, for allowing the DevEx community to come into your session today. I think those of you following on the live stream or watching this recorded later will get, I hope, the impression that I get here, which is that the CIOs of the international organizations in the UN system see their role as bigger than their own organization and want to connect with the broader community. And we will continue to play our role at DevEx to try to make that connection happen and to share that information. So thank you to everyone who's joined us. Thank you very much to those of you who've joined this discussion.